welcome everybody and to this evening's event, which has been brought to you by the 9/11 Truth Alliance, who got word that Susan was coming to town and needed a place, and so we arranged the Lucky Lab as a suitable venue for her kind of talk and book selling, signing event. And I just want to spend a few moments and just talk about the 9/11 Truth Alliance and what we've been up to and what's coming up, and then briefly introduce Susan and get this talk underway. And I assume, you know, you'll talk for a little while and then there'll be some discussion.
Yeah. Lots of questions. Yeah. Anything you want to ask, okay. we'll stay and talk.
All right. And I'm glad you said that, because I think that's a real hallmark of the 9/11 Truth Alliance. It's the thing that's really special about the 9/11 Truth Alliance is that it insists on free thinking and free speech and critical thinking. And it really reacts quickly to gatekeepers. And when, you know, these phrases come up, you know, and a lot of people don't know what they mean offhand, but once you've studied the events of 9/11-2001, it's been almost 10 years now, one realizes that, you know, there are all these cliches that you can throw up, you know, we're in the Matrix, it's 1984, it's all sorts of highly controlled, highly spectacle is being thrown at the public in a very coordinated and nefarious manner, in a way to get the populations of the world to be docile and not think and be afraid and do what they're told and not speak out. And the 9/11 Truth Alliance is one of the few groups that refuses to stop speaking out and to stop thinking. And so by coming here tonight, you're part of this tradition of enlightenment and resistance and truth-seeking. That's kind of been the hallmark of a lot of the higher cultures of this planet, and it's a real disappointment that we seem to be entering this period in which truth and enlightenment, far from being cherished, are being stamped out with the likes of Guantanamo and any other torture chamber you care to name. So, anyway, if you want to talk about these things, you can come to the 9/11 Truth Alliance meetup meeting, which every Saturday morning at 11 o'clock at the True Brew Coffee House, which is on Southeast Milwaukee, just south of Powell Boulevard, on the east side of the street. I don't remember the exact address. It's right there. We meet at 11 for, I don't know, as long as people want to talk, really. And then we also attempt to put together some other events and things. Coming up, of course, is the 10th anniversary of 9/11, 10 years of war and torture and ripping up the Constitution and crashing the economy, and here we are. And we're about to be treated to a media bloodbath in which they're going to rev it all up again, maybe this time for Iran. And we'll be doing our counter events. We're going to, it looks like we will have Jim Fetzer, who has talked about 9/11 also for a real long time. And he'll be speaking on Friday the 9th. And I believe it's going to be at the Selwood Middle, or the Selwood Community Center down in Southeast Portland.
This month?
This September.
Oh,
September. And then on Saturday, in the same building, we hope to have kind of an all-day seminar for beginners and then for more advanced people on the ins and outs of 9/11. I mean, there have been all these fabulous documentaries done about 9/11, all kinds of documentaries done. I mean, there's information up to the wazoo about it, books, etc., etc. It all doesn't appear to pierce the hardcore media grip on reality, but we're going to talk about it anyway. And it's down in the Selwood Community Center, and we're here in the Lucky Lab because the 9/11 Truth Alliance has experienced the backlash of truth-telling in this town. We've had various different events, and we've been chased out of venues time and time again. Chased out of venues, one after another. And, you know, this is the reality of where we are right now. I mean, liberal friends who we thought were liberal friends turned out to just be liberals. And they appear to be just as more in favor of Obama and bombing Libya and attacking Yemen and, you know, shredding the Constitution and instituting, you know, rendition here in the United States. And I guess employing Guantanamo tactics at Pelican Bay and other supermax prisons now in the United States, where there's a hunger strike, which you also wouldn't know about unless you, like, kept your ear extremely close to the ground. I mean, Pelican Bay, our very own Guantanamo, is actually just over the border in California from Oregon, so it's not even just a few hundred miles from here, and they're torturing people right now, right there. So anyway, it's a dark time, but I'm really happy that we're still able to practice our free speech rights and have a speaker like...
For now.
For now, for like Susan Lindauer, who has had her own story to tell of being in the fold of the national security state and then kind of being kicked into the hole for not going along with it.
Yeah.
And I'm really excited to hear her talk about it. I've heard a few of the prices she's had to pay with her family and others, so it's like whenever you really start telling the truth, you've got, I mean, you know, I hate to be so doom and gloom, but you've got to be prepared for the consequences.
There are some serious consequences.
And but at the same time, keep in mind that it's not all about now. It's never always been about now. We're dealing with the future now, and we're fighting for the future. And, you know, that's where we're at. So here we go.
Thank you. Well, I have to say, I am so pleased to be here. I have waited 10 years to tell this story. I remember after 9/11 when my CIA handler, Richard Fuse, told me that there really wasn't going to be much of a 9/11 investigation. And we were going to try to keep the people calm. That's what he said. We're going to keep them calm. And I said, what do you mean? he said, well, we don't really need them to know everything that we were doing before 9/11. And I said, well, why? what do you think's going to happen when they find out that you didn't tell them the truth? Why don't you just tell them the truth right now? And he said, well, that's not really what they want to do. So I had, I had different ideas. I will tell you straight off the bat that right after 9/11, my CIA handler received a $13 million payoff from the 9/11 investigation that was supposed to be money used for the Iraqi, to secure Iraq's cooperation. And I ended up getting indicted on the Patriot Act. I was the second non-Arab American ever indicted on the Patriot Act after Jose Padilla. And my crime was in opposing terrorism and going to Congress, and I had spoken to the staff of Senator John McCain and Senator Trent Lott, and I had pounded them. I called their chiefs of staff, their legislative directors, and their foreign policy people, and I said, I'm an asset who covered Iraq and Libya at the United Nations, and I have a story to tell, and you need to hear what I have to say. And within 30 days, I am not making this up, this is actually thanks to the Patriot Act, all of my phone calls to these offices are taped by the FBI, so I can actually prove that they occurred. And I have the dates, I have the phone, I have the actual phone conversations on tape. And within 30 days of those conversations, I woke up to hear the FBI pounding at my door. And I got up out of bed, and I looked out the window, and there are men in flak jackets in my porch. And I open the door, and they come into my house, and they're like, Ms. Susan, and the FBI agent is shaking. He's shaking. And he said, you are Susan Lindauer. You are hereby notified. You are under arrest on the Patriot Act. And I said, what? You have the right to remain silent, anything you say, et cetera, et cetera. He read me my Miranda rights, and I was just like, What are you talking about? I'm making coffee. You know, I'm not a bank robber. I'm not a drug dealer. I'm not a murderer. I haven't broken any laws that I can think of. And I have no idea what you say that I've done. He said, well, your attorney will explain it to you later on. Okay? Okay. That began a five-year indictment, five-year nightmare on the Patriot Act. I was never taken to trial. In 5 years, I was allowed one morning of testimony with two witnesses. The two witnesses were former chief of staff for a congressional member of Congress, and my old friend Park Godfrey, who verified the 9/11 warnings that I'm going to talk about tonight. And I'm going to tell you, and then I'm going to let you guys ask a lot of questions, and I know you're going to have a lot of questions. I'm going to do my best to answer as honestly as I can. I do not have all the answers, but I will tell you up front that I believe there was both the hijackings, and that does not mean that I'm right and you're wrong. I believe there were both hijackings and a controlled demolition scenario, and I'll explain to you how the whole thing fits together. And you may disagree, and that's okay if you disagree with me. But I can tell you, when you hear what I have to say, you'll understand why I've reached this conclusion. So I believe both of them happened, okay? And it's also very important for you to know that as the 10-year anniversary of 9/11 comes up, no offense, but you guys have no idea what actually happened. This is like the lies are so much bigger than what you know. And it's so much deeper, and it's so much more tragic once you have the truth. So on that note, let me just take you to, I'm going to move you a little bit ahead to remember when George Bush they were counting the votes in Florida. Okay? I'm going to take you back to November of 2000. They had not yet declared that George Bush had won the election. I was having meetings with the full knowledge and permission of the CIA with Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations on resuming the weapons inspections. It is very important for you to understand that this story with 9/11 also ties in deeply to what happened with Iraq. And contrary to everything you were told, the Iraqis were not resistant to weapons inspections. They had a comprehensive agenda. The CIA had already a comprehensive agenda for resolving the entire conflict without war at all. And it involved weapons inspections, cooperation with anti-terrorism, and major financial contracts for U.S. corporations and oil. And this would be developed over a period of time. But we already had, by November of 2000, we already had an agreement with the Iraqi government. We had a framework agreement that was, at that point, it was undefined, not so well defined, and we had to make it defined. But they had already consented to all of these things. They wanted peace with us. And so by February of 2001, the Iraqis had agreed to offer to invite the FBI to send a task force into Baghdad with authorization to conduct terrorism investigations and to make arrests of terror suspects. This is very important for you to understand. So this is like the background of what you have to know. Okay. In April of 2001, I was summoned to this is already happening. The comprehensive peace framework, those discussions are already underway. And I am, at this point, the chief asset covering the Iraqi embassy and the Libya house, both of them, I do both of them, and Yemen and Syria and Egypt and Malaysia. But Iraq and Libya are my primary countries. And so I'm a back channel, which means that the U.S. government gives me messages to give the Iraqis, and then the Iraqis give me messages to give to Washington. So I know everything. Every single conversation is going through me. And I can tell you that in April of 2001, I was summoned to my CIA handler, Dr. Richard Fuse, and he said he had a message for me to deliver to New York at the earliest possible convenience. And the message was this. We are looking for information on a conspiracy to hijack airplanes. We expect the target to be the World Trade Center. We think they're going to fly the airplanes into the World Trade Center. And we want the Iraqis to provide any, it's called actionable intelligence. Actionable intelligence is a name, an airport hub, a flight number, something that's going to help us identify who they are, where they're meeting, what their nationalities are, anything like this. And he says, he gives me a message, and he says, we want this information, and I want you to tell the Iraqis that if they fail to give us this information, and if it is later determined that they knew the information and they did not give it to us, then the United States is prepared to go to war with Iraq. Okay, this is April of 2001. Well, I went up to New York, and I was very, we were in the middle of these great negotiations. We already had an invitation, from February of 2001, we had an invitation for the FBI to come to Baghdad. So I go up to New York, I'm very pleasant, I'm very polite. There's no reason to be nasty with these people, they want peace. I say, hey, could you please send a message to Baghdad? We'd like this information. If you come across anything, you know, Saddam had been one of our best sources on terrorism throughout the 1990s. Iraq hated terrorism because they believed that they hated Islamic jihadis. Whether you like Saddam or not, whether you hate Saddam or not, he hated Islamic conservatives. He was convinced that they would take advantage of the crumbling of authority in Baghdad under the sanctions, and that they would then try to overturn his government, and the poverty of the people from the sanctions would fuel this problem, would help overturn his government. So he wanted to help us at every turn keep these people from becoming too powerful. Okay. And so we knew this. So when I go to New York in April of 2001, I'm very friendly. And I say, hey, look, could you send the message to Baghdad? Let them know we're looking for this. Thanks. And the message from the Iraqis in April of 2001 is, hey, send the FBI. We've already agreed to send the FBI. We've already invited you to send the FBI. Come on. Tell them, just bring them on. Sure. Wow. You didn't know that, did you? Okay. So I go back to I go back to Washington, and I get a phone call from Richard. He said, come down to my office. I want to hear what they said. I go down. I said, oh, I was real polite. I gave him the message. Sure. He said, I didn't tell you to be nice. I told you to tell those. This is going to be on television, right? This is going to be like, okay, well, I'll soft pedal what he said. He was like, you go back to, you stupid, goddamn, blinkety, 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 blinkety. I told you to tell those SOB, MFers, God, GD, blah, 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 screaming, circling me around his conference. I'll never forget it. Circling his conference desk, ranting and raving, waving his arms around. He didn't do that very often. He does not have that kind of personality. He's a very calm man, and he feels that if you're really angry at somebody, then the more calm you are, the more dangerous you are. That's CIA. He's old school CIA. Okay, so he's screaming now. And I go back, he's like, you go back to New York and you deliver the message exactly the way that I told you to deliver the message. And I said, well, Richard, I don't want them to think I'm threatening them because, you know, I believe in, like, negotiations and conflict resolution. He said, no, I don't want them to think you are threatening them. And he said, I don't want them to think I am threatening them. I want you to tell them this threat of war originates at the highest level of government above the CIA director and above the Secretary of State, that it would be three men, President George Bush, Vice President Dick Cheney, and Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld, and no one else. Those are the three people who are threatening war. And I want to be really clear about the message that I was ordered to give them. We demand that you turn over any fragment of intelligence outlining a conspiracy involving airplane hijackings and a strike on the World Trade Center. If you withhold this information, If we discover that you have withheld this information and the attack occurs, then we will bomb you back to the Stone Age. You will be bombed harder than you've ever been bombed before. You will be destroyed. You cannot, you've never been hit the way we're going to hit you now. Okay, so I went up and I delivered that message. This is May of 2001. In June and July, practically every single week, my CIA handler, Dr. Richard Fuse, and I talked about 9/11. And it was very clear that the intelligence community was being prepped for two things. One, to expect airplane hijackings. Now, I have to be honest with you, because I know a lot of you are interested in the controlled demolition. They prepped us to expect the airplane hijackings. They told us about it. My CIA handler demanded that Iraq had to give us this, and they insisted that if it happened, there would be dire consequences. Now, what you're going to see in my book, and we have more copies of my book outside. We've got more here too. There was something else going on that summer that was really beautiful. This peace framework that we had been working on was magnificent. It was turning out just glorious for a peace dividend. The Iraqis were now offering the weapons inspections, which of course the United States had very rigorous standards for the weapons inspections. Iraq was offering cooperation with anti-terrorism to allow the FBI to go in. And Iraq started to offer a lot more. A lot more came on the table. By the summer, by June and July of 2001, Iraq was offering the United States preferential contracts. Now, think about the economy today. Preferential contracts for the United States corporations on telecommunications, healthcare, hospital equipment, pharmaceuticals, transportation. Iraq offered to buy 1 million American-manufactured automobiles every year for 10 years. Think of what that would have done to the economy. Yeah. Think about non-dual-use factory production. And all of this was because the CIA was like, you know, if we're going to give up these darn sanctions, we're going to take a pound of flesh with it. They had no, and whether you like the CIA or not, and most of you, 99% of you don't like the CIA. I realize that, of course. But the CIA was doing what it's supposed to do, whether you like it or not. They were taking care of what is in the best interest of the United States government, with the best interest of the United States economy, and they were not going to let Iraq punish the United States. And I hated the sanctions. I was doing this because I hated the sanctions. I was doing it because I thought, because they had destroyed education, they wiped out literacy in a single generation, they destroyed the hospitals and the healthcare system. Iraq performed the second heart transplant in the world, and we wiped them out. Okay, 11,000 people died every month. By the end of 1996, 500,000 children had died of sanctions, and they only counted 5-year-olds and younger. They didn't even count the 6-year-olds because the United Nations was holding back the numbers. And after that report in December of 96, they stopped counting it. The United Nations never published another report on the deaths. So frequently what you will hear is that only 500,000 children died, but in fact they continued to die, and approximately 1 million children died. They were babies. They weren't even alive when the first Gulf War happened. This was an offense against, you know, this is genocide. This is a mass genocide. So that's my motivation. But the CIA did not have my motivation. They were out to make sure that the United States was not going to be punished for what they had done. And I was like, and believe me, by this point, we just wanted to get rid of the sanctions. The Iraqis were like, if that'll get rid of the sanctions, you bet. We'll give them anything they want. So before 9/11, you could have had every single thing you possibly could dream of. And if the CIA could have thought of more to ask for, we would have. We would have asked for, it was shameless. Okay, so you have peace that's breaking out in the Middle East. You have the 9/11 warnings. And then in August of 2001, we went into high mode, high activity mode. I can tell you the exact day, on August 2nd, and after I tell you this, I'll open it up to questions. On August 2nd was the Senate nomination hearings for Robert Mueller to head the FBI. He was going to be the FBI director. and I was on the phone with my CIA handler, Richard Fuse, and I said, there's not one single terrorism investigation this man hasn't thrown. Oops. That's okay. He threw the Oklahoma City bombing investigation. He threw Lockerbie. And I said, this man should not be the FBI director when this next attack occurs. And Richard Fuse said to me, my God, what if there is no FBI director when this happens? I said, do you think it's that soon? Do you think the attack is imminent? He said, oh, yeah. He said, it's absolutely just in the next couple of weeks. He said, and I said, well, God, Richard, I'll go back to New York right now, and I'll pump the Iraqis and see if they've got anything from Baghdad. I'll see if they have any news for us. And he said, oh, my God, Susan, do not go back to New York City. It's too dangerous. We are expecting the use of a miniature thermonuclear device. And they were not afraid that I was going to be hurt by, like, falling debris in the World Trade Center. I wasn't going to be at the World Trade Center. They were afraid of radiation contamination, like the winds blowing the radioactive stuff. And that's what he was like, don't go up there. We're expecting mass casualties. And I said, well, Richard, you know, I'll go up the day after. This was I can tell you the exact day. It was a Thursday. And I said, I will go up to New York on Saturday, and I'll report to you on Monday. And we'll just find out if the Iraqis have anything to give us. I went up to New York. The Iraqis said, ain't got nothing. We don't know. We don't know anything about this. You keep telling us about this. The only way we know about it is because you're talking about it. But we don't have any information to give you. And if we did, we understand the consequences. We know that if we don't help you, you're going to go to war with us if you think we did. And if there was anything we could give you, we would do it. So I go back and I report that on August 6th. On August 6th, there is a memo to the president telling him that this is a high security threat, that it is an emergency level, that it's imminent. Okay. At my meeting with Richard Fuse, Richard Fuse does something very important. He tells me that because of my direct contacts with Iraq and Libya, I should be the one. I am perfectly positioned, because everyone likes to think that Iraq and Libya are involved in terrorism to begin with. I should be the one to contact U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft's office. And I should tell them that we're looking for what's called an emergency broadcast alert across all agencies, seeking any fragment of intelligence involving airplane hijackings and a strike on the World Trade Center identified specifically. And I make that phone call. My conversation with Refuse is August 6th. Probably August 7th, August 8th, I call them. And immediately I talk to I have a private phone number. See, you guys couldn't get this number, but I have it, okay? I have the number inside the Attorney General's office. I'm not calling a switchboard. I'm calling his private staff, okay? I'm calling his government liaison office. That's not true. I call his private internal office. There are about 20 members of his private staff. His legislative director is there. His government relations person is there. But I call inside that office. And they give me the office for the phone number for the Office of Counterterrorism. They say, repeat exactly what you just told us and tell them. I am told that John Ashcroft said, oh, those CIA people keep talking about terrorism, and they keep talking about this darn airplane hijacking, and they're so paranoid, and why do they keep bugging us about it? That's what I'm told they said. but I did what I did. And when I did that, I apparently tripped some wires, because it denied the White House, it denied the Justice Department and the Attorney General's office of deniability, plausible deniability. And that's very important. And that is why they came after me so hard and tried to destroy me utterly, because they could not admit to you that we had absolutely anticipated this thing. We knew it was going to happen exactly as it did go down, with one exception. And here's where I'm going to finish this, and then I'll open the floor to questions. What I have learned since then, now all the things that I've told you were things I did directly. So I'm telling you, I'm not relating what somebody else did or a conversation that somebody else had that has been reported to me. This is direct primary knowledge from my own experience. But what I'm going to tell you now is from somebody else, okay? And so I distinguish these two things. I have been told that by somebody who saw the videos that at the World Trade Center, from approximately August 23rd, and it could have been August 22nd, it could have been August 24th, okay, approximately August 23rd until approximately September 3rd, and again, it could be September 2nd. The spooks can be weird about this stuff. Okay, they could say, well, it wasn't September 4th. So no. No, it could have been September 3rd, okay? It could have been September 2nd. Right, and within a couple of days of this, my friend says that at approximately 3 o'clock in the morning, strange vans, and there were just maybe three of them, he said, that not just a couple. The way he put it was a couple of vans. So we're thinking three, possibly four, but most likely three. A couple of vans arrived at 3 o'clock in the morning after the janitorial trucks had left the building. It's very important because they were able to identify the vans according to make, model, color, and there were no markings on the vans. But the janitorial vans did have markings. And so they were able to distinguish that these are not the same vans. And they know how the janitorial trucks left the building, and they actually tracked the paths that the janitorial trucks took to drive home. Like the janitorial workers were driving down certain roads to get over to their houses, and the CIA, or the FBI, the NSA folks tracked those people home. He was quite convinced that these are not the same trucks. And between the hours of 3 o'clock and 5 o'clock, these trucks had never been in this building before. It was an anomaly. Definitely, it wasn't like it was going on for months and months and it just continued. They showed up for 10 days, 10 or 11 days approximately, then they were never seen again. And that's when they believe they wired the building. And they do believe, and my friend told me absolutely it was a thermite bomb with potential sulfur in it. Yeah. The sulfur the important thing about a thermite bomb is it is an extraordinary heat reducing bomb. Okay, it takes steel and it creates molten steel. So it takes beams of steel and it turns it into molten steel. And it just rot, everything underneath just sinks into the ground like what you saw. And it is a special U.S. military grade weapon. Okay? It is a military grade weapon. It's not something you could make ever in your kitchen or your garage or your living room. It is impossible for you to do this. This is a U.S. military weapon. And so I do believe that helps to explain some of the missing pieces, and I believe this is what happened. They had known about the terrorist attack for months. There is a long-term advance knowledge. Assets are being watched. The so-called terrorists, whether you want to think of them as whether they're real, Mohammed Atta was an asset. Trained by the United States government, supervised by the United States government. And I can assure you that assets, and I'm speaking directly from my own personal experience, assets are heavily controlled individuals. I was never dealing with Iraq and Libya without somebody paying extremely close attention to me at every stage, and my phones were tapped. I mean, at some point they had wired my house. When they had the handover of the two Libyan men, I went down to my basement the same day that they handed over the men, and my ceiling of my basement had been torn out, and there were cable wires dangling from the ceiling, about a dozen cable wires. And I had a contractor come over to my house, and he said, "Wow, somebody really put a kick-ass stereo system in your house. That's amazing." He said, You have these wires going to every single room of your house, even in your bathroom. And I was like, ew. You know? But he said, it's everywhere. He said, you must have like a stereo system that just, you know, rocks in this house. But the point is that assets There's no way that these assets could have functioned without everyone knowing every single detail of what they were doing. There's no way they could have hidden. They could not have disguised their actions from their handlers. Even if they tried to disguise it, it wouldn't work. Believe me, it wouldn't work. It's impossible. Impossible. And so it's more likely that they were using Mohammed Atta to guide the conspiracy, to track the conspiracy, and then they discovered that they were bozo pilots, they were clowns, they weren't any good at this flying stuff, and now they had an agenda. And the agenda was that when this attack happened, they were going to go to war with Iraq. But, oh gosh, we've got a problem now. Because the problem is they're not going to be able to do the job. Uh-oh. Oh, what a bummer. We're not going to be able, because here's the thing about all, and I'm speaking now again from experience. The 1993 World Trade Center attack killed 5 people. The bombing of the USS Cole killed 12 people. And once the smoke clears and the catastrophe, the chaos is over and the noise is done, it's pretty, you know, it's like, it's all, there's not a lot of damage that would certainly not enough that would allow a government, a pro-war cabal, to throw itself into a new war with Iraq, which they wanted to do. They'd already decided to do it. And so that is the motivation. Any police officer will tell you, there is no crime without a motive and opportunity. And we had both. So it's not like they just spontaneously wired the World Trade Center. They knew it was coming, and they wanted to make sure that they had maximum damage when it hit. They knew they were going to use the airplanes as the cover to demolish the building. So it's not, you know, a lot of people in the 9/11 truth community have gotten kind of, at first, when I first broke this news, they were like, you know, a lot of people attacked me, and they said, you're saying there were airplane hijackings. No, no, there was a demolition. And I'm like saying, no, no. There's both of it. Both things happened. They knew this. They knew the airplanes were going to be hijacked, so they used it as a cover for the to guarantee maximum destruction because they already knew the consequence of war. So, there you have it. Sure. And okay, yeah.
I forget what you said that your job was. You're a go-between. Or...
What's called an asset.
Right. Okay.
I was an intelligence asset. I was supervised by handlers for the CIA and the Defense Intelligence Agency. I was not covert. I was covert from your end. Like you guys, the American people had no idea that President Clinton had opened up a back channel because they didn't want you all to know this. But in fact, from the very first meetings that I have at the Iraqi embassy and the Libyan embassy, they were told who I was. They knew that I was a passionate anti-sanctions activist and passionately anti-war. I hated the first Gulf War, had protested the Gulf War, and I wanted to do anything that I could to try to create a communications. They couldn't have a formal communications because of the sanctions. They were officially on the pariah list, and yet they had to have some kind of communications and discussion in order to on terrorism specifically.
So my question is, you were a back channel between everybody. I find it odd that your boss doesn't talk to the people in the administration.
Oh, they did.
They send you over there to yell at people.
Well,
tell them.
I think that he did. I know that he did. I know that he did. What he did was, I believe, and I could be wrong about this, but I believe that he contributed to the White House memo on the presidential directive, instruction, request. there's a formal term for that. I'm afraid I don't know what it is. I can't remember off the top of my head what it is. He did contribute to that, and he had vastly more information than I did. I was getting all my knowledge from him. But the fact that we needed fast turnaround on this because we thought the attack was within a couple of weeks. In fact, the attack didn't occur for another... This was August 6th, and it occurred over a month later. But we thought that the attack could come as early as, you know, the third or fourth week of August. We thought it was imminent.
And so... Why did he have you go to the
Well, he probably did also. Everybody was doing it. See, this is the thing that, I mean, not, no offense, but there was so much discussion about this attack. Everybody was talking about it. George Tenet had some meetings. Other analysts had meetings at the White House that Condoleezza Rice has, like, conveniently pretended didn't happen. But there was a lot of knowledge, and the fact that I would be able to get the Attorney General's attention, the staff attention, by saying I'm in direct contact with Iraq, that's kind of like a bona fide thing that in the CIA that's like they call it bona fide.
So more information to them is better.
Yeah, exactly. We were, and it wasn't like a supervisory thing at that point. They wanted someone with direct contact because I had direct contact with the events, and I could cite that and say, you need to listen to me, because I spoke with the Iraqis on Saturday, and I need to tell you this. I spoke, you know, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's, I'm sure he also did, I know he did other things too.
Okay. In the course of your talk, what I haven't heard is any real evidence that there was a genuine jihadi plot. Maybe that's in your book, but you haven't said anything to show me that such a plot existed. In fact, the impression I get from the evidence that you presented about what your bosses were talking about and what was going on in the U.S. government is that the U.S. government was trying to create a predictive situation,
yes,
with this attack,
yes,
which in my opinion could well have been the sum and substance of the attack, and that, you know, as I said, I haven't seen anything that you said that shows me that there was a genuine jihadi plot.
You know, this is a very good question, because it's really questionable that there was a jihadi plot. I do believe there were hijackers. Now, I have to tell you that I do believe there were hijackers. On the other hand, I know that they were, the people that they did identify were assets. Okay? They worked for the United States government. And they were the men who were identified as the hijackers were not jihadis. They were not devoutly religious men. They went to strip clubs. They drank alcohol. They smoked cigarettes. They chased women. Real deep, authentic jihadis would do none of that. They were, you know, and so it's really curious to me as to what their, and I don't have an answer for you, unfortunately, but what their final minutes must have been on this earth. What did they think they were doing? I truly do not know. I don't know if they thought it was just a training exercise. I don't know if they thought, I just don't know. But I do not believe they were jihad, real jihadis.
One other point. You say that there was a point in midsummer 2001 when the CIA and elements in the U.S. government may have become concerned that having planned this event and prepared for it, that the alleged jihadi pilots weren't going to be able to accomplish the goal.
Yeah.
Well, now, according to the official version of 9/11, they did accomplish the goal of flying the airplanes into the buildings. And so, do you think that the CIA made a mistake and underestimated the talent of these pilots?
Well, here's the thing. They did fly into the building. Of course, they did. And they could have been on automatic pilot. That makes sense. We know that there was a heightened GPS and heightened cell phone activity that is very unusual. Usually the GPS only works to, it doesn't work at certain altitudes. And at a scale of like 1 to 10, the GPS signal was working at a 10, whereas ordinarily it might work at a 4. See? And so something was helping boost, and it had to be boosted. It could not have, it couldn't have just spontaneously done this on its own. Something had to be boosting the GPS signal. And that's, and it's just a matter of scientific requirement that it had to be boosted, and it was. The cell phone was the same thing. I, you know, some people have tried to say that the cell phone conversations did not happen. I do believe they did happen. I do believe that people got through to their spouses. But again, you see that it had to be some, there had to be some technological boost for it to be done. And I think that they got, the hijackers got a lot of help. They got a lot of help.
My general view, this is sort of what I'm asking, is that's what I thought actually happened, was it was both, you know, the planes and the demolition bomb.
Yeah.
But without a lot of information, that's just what seemed to make sense. What, if you consider problems I'm having, if you consider books like Russ Baker's Family Secrets, Annie Jacobson's Area 51, that just came out recently, and the last one I just read was Naomi Wolf's The End of America.
Yes.
And
good. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's just so random. So how can you expect us, knowing the corruption of moral character, which is what I believe what it is, I think fundamentally where we're at is a spiritual crisis, in essence, the big picture.
Yeah.
And so I'm sort of interested in you in part of that, because I'm sure there are people that are dedicated in the CIA that are very trustworthy.
Well,
I mean, well, I'm trustworthy in the sense that their motivations are clear. But I think overall, considering all the torture and the long history that it's had, and you can't believe anything, basically. You can't. You just don't know. There's so much spin with it.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm not saying there's not dedicated individuals. I think there are.
Sure.
I don't think everybody's black and white.
Sure.
So what I'd like to get from you in part is first of all, your picture of the big overall, what's the primary motivation of the war, but who, I mean, what is the big picture? Who are the big honchos at the top that are directing it?
Well, I'd like to answer this on a couple of levels. First of all, the CIA has a long track record of doing a false flag operations on itself. And one of the reasons that I may be more trustworthy is that I have I was an asset, not a CIA director. My CIA handler received $13 million tax free. Didn't even have to pay a dollar in taxes. Is that not the sweetest thing you've ever heard in your life? From the 9/11 investigation of emergency appropriations that were intended for the Iraq's to secure Iraq's cooperation. And he took the money, and you've never heard him speak. And he, when I was under indictment, my own CIA handler refused to speak to my attorneys for 5 years. If he had spoken to my attorneys at any time at all, we could have ended my indictment entirely. But the other thing is that I was, the reason you should trust me is because I paid for this. I was locked up in prison on a military base for a year, and I was held under indictment for 5 years. And they were, so the government was so, if you do a little research on my story, you'll find the government was so threatened by what I was going to say that they actually argued to, this is like a record. There's a history of this. You can confirm this. They wanted to forcibly drug me with Haldol, Ativan, and Prozac, which would have chemically lobotomized me, because they said that I was, they admitted that I was not hallucinating, I do not suffer depression. For those of you who do suffer depression, sorry, but I don't. I don't have mood disturbances. They said I had good eye contact, I was cooperative, smiling. They could not identify anything wrong with me except that I argued that I had, my defense was I had worked in anti-terrorism for 9 years, and I warned about 9/11, and my team warned about 9/11. And they were like, they tried to detain me up to 10 years. They actually petitioned the court for the right on the Patriot Act for the right to detain me up to 10 years in prison with no trial and no hearing. Imagine that. The government is arguing that we don't have to give this woman a hearing. We can just lock her up indefinitely. And I was the test case on this, and it was horrible. And they wanted to lock me up and forcibly drug me at the same time so that I would be so destroyed. They told the judge that they had no idea how long my cure was going to take, but they wanted it. The judge in my case was Michael Mukasey. Michael Mukasey later became U.S. Attorney General, and I fought so hard, and my beloved companion, sweet, wonderful Jay Fields, who died of cancer, unfortunately, never lived to see me exonerated. He fought in the blogs, and he fought on alternative radio, because the corporate media refused to cover my story. They would not, they didn't want to tell you what was going on. They said that they implied very strongly that I was a religious maniac. And I do believe in God, and I have a spiritual life. Yes, I do, but I'm not a religious maniac. I guess a religious maniac would be someone like the Elizabeth Smart rapist, kidnapper, who went into court and was like spouting religious stuff and was singing up hymns, standing up and singing hymns in court, stuff like that. They wanted me to. Yeah, yeah, it was. And when they realized that there was actually a, I call it my Amnesty International moment. They had already, the Justice Department had already petitioned to forcibly drug me, and I was waiting for a decision. And one morning I was locked up in prison at this point. I had been held on Carswell Air Force Base for 8 months, and then I was moved to the Metropolitan Correctional Center in New York for 4 months. And one morning, at 5:30 in the morning, the guard wakes me up, he shakes me, he said, "You're going to court today." And I'm like weeping. I'm thinking that they've got the decision and they're going to like send me back to Carswell to be drugged, and I'm hysterical. I was absolutely hysterical. And I get into the courtroom, and I'm in a holding cage that's about the size of this table. And they come in, my attorney comes in, and he says, "Oh my God, someone has started a blog on your case, and people are writing your judge. They're writing Judge Mukasey. You got to tell your friend to stop doing this." I was like, "Never, no, no way." And I was like, "We are no," and literally I grabbed the bars. I was like, "We are never going to stop. We are going to fight to defend this Constitution. You are breaking the law. And we are never going to shut up until this is done. You can tell that crooked prosecutor that he can just go to hell, because we're going to keep talking until, you're never going to shut me up now." You know, this was a mistake. This was a huge mistake that they did this to me. And we went in, and the judge was like, And at that point, Jay had published psych records. After my arrest, I had been ordered to have this actually saved me. I had been ordered to attend weekly psychology meetings. I had never had any psychological problems, and I had a year's worth of documentation saying that I suffered no mental illness, no depression, no psychosis, no mania, no nothing, no mood disturbances. And these are in the back of my book, so you can actually look at this stuff for yourself, and you can see the papers with your own eyes. And you can read them. And the judge was like, "Well, this is extraordinary. You're telling me this woman is incompetent and she's suffering from this grave mental illness, and yet she has all these records which are on the bloody internet. Why are these papers not in my courtroom?" And the judge was like, "Uh-uh, this is just not going to happen." And at that point, I was saved. Because the judge was like, this woman is not cooperative. You know, if I had been cooperative, they would have done it. If I had been passive, they would have done it. But, I mean, I'm a fighter, and they still wouldn't give me a hearing. And, I mean, I know how to fight. I'm an activist and an asset. Believe me, I know how to fight. And they would, and it was like the Patriot Act was so hideous, so big, so powerful, that there was nothing that they were going to let it break through. But Judge Mukasey also did the financial case on the 9/11, the insurance claims for 9/11. For Larry Silverstein, who went to his synagogue They both attend the same synagogue. Yeah.
Cozy.
Very cozy.
Did Muhammad Atta willingly sacrifice himself, or didn't he know what was going to happen to him?
I do not know. I do not know. I wonder about all these things, because I wonder if they thought that it was like a practice, or if they thought, you know, this was just like, I do not know the answer to that. It's like, it's fascinating to think what they must have thought.
There were foreign newspapers that reported that many of the hijackers are still alive.
Yes.
I think 6 or 7 of them were reported. One is a pilot for the Saudi Arabian Airlines, I believe. One lives in Los Angeles. So there was all this, and then there was the report.
That's
that
true.
Muhammad, yeah. So it doesn't make sense that there were these hijackers that hijacked planes. I mean, obviously something is wrong with this story.
Yeah.
If these people are still alive.
I wonder though if it was those. Yeah. I don't have as an asset. This may frustrate. This is probably going to frustrate you. I'm trained to stop where I have. It's very much compartmentalized, and there are certain things that I know from my own direct personal experience that I can tell you, and then there are other things that I'm taught just to say, to draw a line. And it may drive you crazy, but there are some things that I cannot answer because I don't know. And as an asset, I'm told to stop and to always to distinguish what I actually know from what I don't know. And that's one of the things I don't know. Sorry. But I do believe there were hijackings. But
hold on to the story that there were hijackings.
Well, I
and then
I do
have
believe
the hijackers alive. I don't know.
Well, but we don't necessarily know who the hijackers were.
We also have other information that some of the serial numbers of the planes were located several years later, as the planes are still in existence. So there's a lot of like really
very strange.
Very strange. There's a lot of strange. And then that plane that went down in Pennsylvania with no plane parts.
That was
no
shot down.
No plane parts anywhere.
There was a plane that was shot down, and I know that there was a pilot who shot down one of the airplanes. And he is locked up in prison in Florida right now.
What's his name?
I don't know. I could get it for you. I will get it for you. I've been told his name before, and I'm actually doing a radio interview with Michael Herzog tomorrow, who's the one who told me about the guy. And I will get that information, and I will pass it to our friend over here, and we'll get that to you. Because he needs help. The last I heard, he was still in. It could be that I hope he's been released. But the last, and he may have been released by now, but the last I heard, he was still in prison. And if he is still in prison, it'd be awfully nice if you guys could help him.
Who's to gain? Who's to lose?
Well, I believe, I mean, the tragedy was that it was so, before 9/11 ever happened, they already knew about this peace framework. And they already knew that they could have, the United States would receive no punishments at all they would not face any problems because of the years of support for the sanctions. The Iraqis wanted the sanctions off so badly that they were going to give the United States everything that they could have wanted. So this is even going on before 9/11 happens. And they were going to give them, you know, 1 million American-made automobiles every year, telecommunications, that would be satellites, phone, TV, every, you know, the CIA could have been, you know, snooping through all the Middle East phone conversations. It was crazy what they lost. Healthcare, hospital equipment, pharmaceuticals, just on and on, just amazing things.
So
oil. Yeah, they could have had everything, even oil. And the only group that wasn't going to benefit was the military-industrial complex, because this would have been peace. This would have been a very prosperous peace. Believe me, the CIA was driving a hard bargain. Anything that we could think to add, I mean, and I have to say, again, I'm anti-sanctions, so I know that a lot of people would say, well, that's not fair to do to the Iraqis, and I agree with you. I agree with you. But it was what the CIA wanted, and they were going to have every single thing that they could think to get. And they wanted, and at the same time, we all knew that it would have to be tremendous to appease George Bush, because he was out for, you know, the Daddy Bush fantasy, this delusion. It was a delusion. But the one group that was not going to benefit was the military-industrial complex. And they were going to be the big losers in this whole thing. They were not going to be able to have their wars. They were not going to be able to sell their military weapons systems. The $400 billion, we wouldn't need all the, for this equipment or that equipment. They wouldn't need any of it. And so they were the losers, and they were just too powerful. You know?
Okay, this isn't actually a question, but a brief comment.
Okay.
We were talking about the Pennsylvania Flight 93 crash, alleged crash.
Yeah.
And I just want to say that anyone can claim to have, any pilot could claim to have shot down the airliner. That's easy to claim something like that, but did it happen? And I just want to point out that not only was there no plane debris at the alleged crash site, but neither was there a debris field anywhere else. And we know from incidents like Lockerbie that when a plane blows over land, it leaves a debris field. But there was no debris field to be shown. So,
well, it's also the Pentagon. It's also the Pentagon. I do not believe that the Pentagon was hit by an airplane. I mean, they're saying that all that debris suddenly was magically just removed. You know, there was no airplane there either. So it's, you know, there's still a lot of questions about 9/11 that I cannot answer for you, and I'm sorry. I wish I, you know, these are good questions you're asking. And it's not like I'm trying to blow you off. There's just some things I don't know. But hopefully I'm going to give you enough new information that you'll be able to, like, put some more pieces of it together.
Yeah, you mentioned your compartmentalized structure of the agency.
Yeah.
And I think that's pretty well understood how one person can be sitting here working on a project, the next person's there, and they can't, you know, they're not allowed to really to look at what the other one's doing.
Yes.
In light of that, I think you're probably aware that it's been documented there were somewhere in the neighborhood of 25 military drills running on 9/11.
Yes.
That is absolutely unprecedented.
Uh-huh.
Not only that, there was one drill that was specifically on a hijacking that exactly the scenario that we're told transpired. And it's you've probably studied Webster Griffin Tarpley's analysis of this 9/11 synthetic terror made in USA, how he breaks this down very convincingly, I believe, that the operation was conduited through the drills.
Uh-huh.
And certain people were doing certain things and probably didn't even know that they were involved in an operation this big.
Yes.
And couldn't share information because of this compartmentalization. And I'm just wondering if you've had an opportunity to talk after all of your ordeal with anybody else who was able to confirm any of this.
Well, I will tell you that the 9/11 conspiracy is based on something called Project Bojinka. And are you all familiar with Project Bojinka? Okay, Bojinka was designed by Ramzi Youssef, who was the mastermind of the 1993 World Trade Center attack. And he conceived that 11, in his grand scheme, 11 airplanes would be hijacked and would strike different targets all over the United States. The World Trade Center would be one, and then they would hit the White House, they'd hit the Justice Department, they'd also hit like Chicago, they'd hit Los Angeles, and throughout the whole country there'd be strikes. And the military discovered this when they found, or the CIA discovered this when they arrested Ramzi Youssef in the Philippines in 1995, and they found the blueprint for this 9/11, what became the 9/11 attack, on his computer. Okay, and he called it Project Bojinka. And at that point, the military began to run simulated counter strategies for what you would do if there was an airplane hijacking scenario that was attacking various targets throughout the United States, and one of the targets was the Pentagon, and then the Pentagon said it was too outrageous that nobody would actually attack the Pentagon this way, so maybe they should drop the Pentagon scenario, so they did. But even though they had rehearsed Project Bojinka, on 9/11, on September 10th through September 12th, NORAD was on high alert doing military exercises because allegedly the former Soviet Union, the Russians, were doing their military exercises. So we timed our military exercises allegedly to theirs. And they were supposed to be on heightened alert just in the course of practice. They were supposed to be on heightened alert for any invasion of sovereignty of airspace, sovereign airspace, on those dates. And yet, even though the military was on high alert, they took no action when the airplanes were hijacked and they didn't scramble. They didn't do any, they broke all of their own protocols.
But weren't they mostly sent up in directions away from the
Eastern Seaboard? There you go. Yeah, yes, yes, yes. And they sent one jet. They turned one jet around and sent it after one fighter to go track down.
They were already on drills
and exercises that had already taken them out and basically left the Eastern Seaboard.
Yes.
And this is supposed to be the smartest military in the world, right?
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
Any consequences for anybody for the reaction?
Exactly. Well, it was embarrassment.
Putting someone into prison or something like this?
Well, other than me and the guy who was allegedly flying the plane that was involved in the shooting down 93, who they don't want you to know about, who's been who was held in prison for a couple of years at least, and I don't know if he's out or not. I mean, they gave him a real hard time, so. Yeah.
Susan, could you remind me again what the sanctions were for in Iran? And two questions. And then
sure.
I just wanted to get clear about what you were arrested for.
Good. The sanctions were on to punish Iraq for allegedly having weapons of mass destruction. And they said that they would keep the sanctions on Iraq until all weapons of mass destruction were confirmed to have been destroyed. Now, it appears that they were actually destroyed by the end of 96 or 97, but the United States had an ulterior agenda, which was they were not going to let go of the sanctions until Saddam was out of power. But what had happened was, by the year 2000, while Bill Clinton was still in office, the international loathing for sanctions had become intense. 2 million people had died from sanctions. Between 1.7 million and 2.2 million had died. And the international community was violating the sanctions. The German pilots were Jordanian pilots were, and actually it was coming from all over Europe. Germany was the first, and they had pilots fly humanitarian supplies over the air through sovereign airspace and land at Baghdad airport, and then a whole bunch of other countries followed suit, and they were all like, we're not going to do this. This is wrong. It is immoral. It is a crime against humanity, and we recognize that. And so at that point, the CIA, I wanted to do it, but at that point, the CIA knew that they were losing control of the situation and that they better step in and do something. And I wanted to end the sanctions, so I was glad the pilots were doing this. But the CIA was very, very expedient. It was politically expedient. They had they were losing control of the situation. They wanted to take back their power. I was accused of several things. One, I was accused of acting as an unregistered Iraqi agent because I had delivered a letter to my cousin, who was the chief of staff to George Bush, telling him that the war in Iraq would be catastrophic and begging him and outlining several of the consequences, like democracy would throw power to Islamic fundamentalists and there would be a rise of terrorist attacks, and the Iraqi people hated the sanctions, and they would hate America for having done all this. And if they could get their hands on America, it would just be a very ugly, brutal occupation, and they'd fight us. That was my letter. I went to jail for that. But they also accused me of they called it unlawful financial transactions. I was accused, I'm not making this up, of eating, allegedly eating three lunches with Iraqi diplomats totaling $92.92. We have the receipts. And they brought criminal, they called that a felony. I was accused there were secret charges against me, which we have deduced. We were never allowed to know what they were. See, on the Patriot Act, let me just tell you a little bit, because I think this is a good opportunity to explain. When I was indicted, under the Patriot Act, they're allowed to have secret charges and secret evidence and secret grand jury testimony. This is very much, the Patriot Act is modeled on the pretty much verbatim, in many page upon page, identical to the old communist criminal, there's a long name for it, the Soviet Criminal Act, which set up the KGB apparatus and allowed people to make accusations against their neighbors without identifying themselves. And it set up the whole gulag system. And the Patriot Act is modeled on that Soviet law, the Soviet Criminal Act. And it's, you know, almost verbatim to what that is. So, I mean, this is a really scary, scary law. But I was accused of, like, possibly, in the secret charges, we believe the secret charges was that I received a book from the Iraqis that was a book on depleted uranium. And that was considered classified because if we were to tell American soldiers about the health risks and the rise of cancer rates and birth defects, then it might demoralize American soldiers. Okay? And another thing was that Saddam's government tried, I'm not making this up, another secret charge was that because I know what I was doing in the periods they'd have a date, and I would know approximately what I was doing on that date. And so another one was that the Iraqis tried to give the Bush administration several $100,000 in campaign contributions so that during the presidential election, because they wanted to show that they wanted to be friends with America. And I was ordered, I had reported that to my defense intelligence handler. He was like, holy shit, you got to tell the Iraqis not to do this. You got to make them not do this. And because it reminded them all of the Asian fundraising crisis under Clinton. And he said, don't they watch from C-SPAN? Don't they know they're not supposed to do this? And he said, you go back and you tell them that if we find out they gave money to the Republican Party in this campaign, we're going to bomb them. We're going to, you know, but see, at this point, Iraq had been bombed so many times, you couldn't threaten them with bombing anymore because they'd already been attacked. What? How are you going to, like, impress on people who, oh, you're going to bomb us again? Okay. Sure. You know. So.
Rewind to earlier in the talk. 20 minutes. But I just wanted to know how you knew that Muhammad Atta was a CIA asset.
That's been very well established. They've admitted that he was a CIA asset.
So could you send me like a reference or something so I would be able to verify that? Can you something?
I will find a reference for you and give it to these guys and yeah, sure. I'll get you some references on that. But it has been verified that he was. And he received some military training too. Sorry.
So, you know, I look at the audience here. We're pretty old. Do you go to Do you go to universities or high schools or because, you know, young people can steer things up, you know, and do some major changes, you know? Do you do that, or they say, no, you cannot
well,
do that?
Well, actually, I've really just started doing this because my book came out just 6 months ago. And so I've done a lot of radio, and I've done a lot of blogging, and which is more youth, I guess, more younger. I don't know if that's not fair. That's not really fair to say that it's younger people. But I do a lot of radio and a lot of, you know, people, a lot of new media stuff. I would love to do that. This is really my first kind of book tour. So, but I would love to go to college campuses.
Okay.
I'm just kind of figuring out how to do it. Because part of the problem is the corporate media will not cover my story at all. Even when I was locked up in prison, one of my favorite stories, I know you guys all love Amy Goodman, but Amy Goodman told my, Amy Goodman, Yeah. Well, you gotta hear what she did to me. When I was locked up, my boyfriend called her and talked to her producers and said, please, you know, Susan is the cousin of the chief of staff to the president. She covered the Iraqi embassy. She warned about 9/11. She's locked up on a military base on the Patriot Act, and they're refusing to give her a hearing. And she was the chief asset covering Iraqi pre-war intelligence. The government is saying that she's incompetent, and they're saying that that assets were incompetent, and yet she's accused, and he gave her the letter, the Andy Card letter, and said, you know, she wrote this letter, and she turned out it was right on all fronts, and couldn't you please interview her? Couldn't you do a story? Please help us. And she, you know what she did? She said, well, you know, maybe her attorney thinks this is a good strategy. We wouldn't want to upset things for settling the case.
She'd been told to stay away from the story.
Yeah, but you know, she did. She took it, she did it herself, and she's to blame for it. And I will tell you, I will never forgive Amy Goodman for that. And my boyfriend was like in tears. He was weeping. I mean, he was a military. He was a retired Navy guy. And you guys, you know, Navy guys don't, I mean, you know men, you know, he's like, some men don't cry. He cried. He broke down in tears. And you know, men is hard for sometimes. For some men, not all men, some men cry. I know that, but he did. He was really upset, and he was just like, she won't do this. And he was just like heartbroken. And he was heartbroken for me. And he was just like, and I was locked up in prison at the time, and I'm on the prison phone. What the fuck do you mean Amy Goodman won't do this? How could she not think this is a right story? What did you say to her to make her not do this story? And he was like, I don't know. I told her. I said, did you say this and this and this? And he said, yeah. So.
Yeah, I heard you on the Jeff Prince program last week.
On Libya.
So that's very similar, isn't it, to what's happening in Iraq.
There is no reason for the United States to be invading Libya at all. There is no justification for this. It's ironic because we're fighting Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Iraq, and Libya is actually, the Libyan rebels are radical Islamists who are trying to institute Sharia. And whether you like Sharia or whether you like the Islam, whether you like Gaddafi or not, see, this is where it gets you, you're an asset. Whether you like Gaddafi, you may hate him, you may think he's bad, but the facts are that the rebels are Islamic radicals. They do want to institute Sharia, and at least be honest and say it, because that's what you're going to get. And don't pretend you're somewhere else. Don't pretend these are people who are doing something different than what you say. That is what their goal is. And they don't want democracy. Gaddafi has been in power for 41 years, and I know it's time for change, but he has also had a tremendous track record on women's rights. They do not have to wear the abaya. They are free not to get married if they don't want to. They are free to get, women are free to get divorces if they want. And the kind, when we talk about Sharia, what I mean is that the Libyan rebels want the women to wear the burqa. An abaya is the burqa where they cover their hair and stuff. They don't have to do that now. They're going to have to do it in the future. They do not want the women to have the right to reject marriage proposals. Under Gaddafi's government, they have an imam actually visits the women before a marriage and sits them with them privately, which is really unheard of, and makes sure that the women are not being pressured into a marriage. And if the woman says that, young woman says that she is being pressured, the imam is, under the law of Libya, the imam has to protect the woman from the abuse of the relatives. And so he has to give her a chance to reject the marriage when nobody is there to pressure her to do it. Because Islam, because this is what happens in Islamic families. Right now there is a counter coup going on in Libya, in Benghazi. And there's all kinds of dramatic stuff that's happening. So Gaddafi's
calling strikes on each other.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's true. So, but it's still, it's you know, so.
Hasn't Gaddafi been a pretty good ally for the West in recent years?
Absolutely.
So why is you, why is NATO supporting the rebels if they're in favor of Sharia? I don't understand why NATO's supporting.
It is very interesting. Gaddafi has, Libyan oil costs $1 per barrel to produce, and the United States had preferential contracts already. The United States and France and Britain all had, they could take as much oil as they wanted. And most of the oil does not come to the United States. It does, however, go to Italy and France and Britain. So it's a major source of European oil. And yet, what Gaddafi was doing was, Gaddafi also has gold. And I think it's very interesting that we have this major financial crisis, and now we're attacking a country that has both oil and a huge private reserve of gold on its own land, and like 500, I would have to double check this fact, but it's like 500 tons of gold in its bank vaults.
143.
143, I stand corrected. 143 tons of gold, correct?
Something like that.
And we're trying to take their gold and their oil. And it's so dirty, it's a dirty fight, and it's just...
Fundamentalists want to let us have the oil and the gold once they win.
Well, that, you know, you should be in Washington. That's the kind of thing that makes sense. But that's what they, you know, the Americans are choosing to believe that they're going to have this sweetheart deal. And I am agreeing with you. I think that as soon as they get in, they're going to say, you know, too bad. It's like, you know, and privately, I get emails from some of these. I mean, because they know me, that they know that I'm out there. I'm against the rebels. And they do send me, I do get emails that are very nasty emails. And they said, do you really think we'll sell out and give you our gold for free? Do you really think we're going to do that? And I'm like, well, I think that Hillary Clinton thinks you're going to do it. And I think that you know, David Cameron in Britain thinks you're going to do it. And also, I do have documentation that Israel has promised. I actually have an Israeli military document, okay, in Hebrew that I've had translated. And it says that the Israelis are, and okay, this is just what it says, that this is a primary document, and I have, you know, it says that Israel will provide financial support to the rebels in exchange for a military base in Libya, in the Green Mountains, and that they call it, the military base will be called One by One. And the Green Mountains is where close to where the gold is, which I find very interesting. So,
I just have a brief point about.
Okay.
There's one woman who's had her hand on all night.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Please.
And I'm a woman.
Okay, that's good.
Susan, I'm really. I'm very interested in your constitution. How you're dealing with all of this. I've been really impressed with all the interviews I've heard, and you seem to be like a really grounded, confident, yet buoyant person, and I don't know, just hearing what you have, like a sense of humor and the sense of irony, I like to think I have that, but how do people go through what you've gone through, like all, you know, are people we know being called into grand jury, being put into what's the detention called? With
the communication center detention, that is a very scary
condition. And Bradley Manning, like when it gets that bad, like how can we be sure that people can still stand up and talk like you are today?
Well, I'll tell you, when I was locked up in Carswell, I cried every day. And when I first went in, I was there supposedly, when I first went in, I was told it was going to be 4 months and then I'd be released. And the first 4 months, I was okay. Because I was like, you know, I'm going to get out of this. You know, and I'm going to tell, you know, and boy, am I going to have a story to tell, and they're not going to shut me up. But when they refused to release me, and I realized that I was not going home, and they said, and at that point, they dropped the bomb on me that they were trying to hold me indefinitely. And only when I thought I was going to be held indefinitely, and then that continued for another 8 months, I became absolutely terrified out of my mind, and I began to have very serious post-traumatic stress.
Well, you were saying you hadn't gone through depression before, and I was just wondering how...
I went through deep anxiety, and I was just... It was like my blood pressure was... the stress level was like a war. a constant war. I was so frightened. I actually colored my hair. Okay? My hair actually went white. And it did. It went white.
So you had contact with people you needed to have contact with?
No. And I'll tell you something. I was locked in prison, and they would not let at that point I had a public attorney who made no effort to get me out. And my uncle, who God bless his heart, lived in Illinois, was driving 700 miles. He was an attorney, though. He had 40 years of experience in corporate law. So he was not a criminal attorney, but he'd had a very good, he was an outstanding attorney. He read the law. He read up on my type of law. He studied what I needed to do and to get move out of the situation. And he made three efforts to see me. But because I was locked up in what they call a communications center. Yeah, scary, scary people. Yeah, and all the political prisoners, all the women political prisoners are being held in Carswell. So if any of you guys are ever arrested on the Patriot Act, you'll be seeing the inside of Carswell too. But they don't have to let the attorneys onto the base. And so even though he was both family and an attorney, and he was coming on visiting hours, he was showing up when when other family members were allowed on the base. Like if you were in prison and you would be able to have your family members show up, he wasn't asking for any special privileges. We filled all the forms. It was all reported correctly. He would show up at the base and they would say, "You're going to see that Iraqi agent. You are not coming into our base. No, there is no prison here." And then they said there was no visiting hours on the weekends. And other people were going right around him and they said, "You can go in. You can go in. You are not going in." And he drove 700 miles in each direction. And believe it or not, there's an affidavit from him in the back of my book. And so it's all, what I'm telling you is confirmed. It's like, it sounds extraordinary, but it is confirmed. But how did I keep my spirits up? I was terrorized. I was absolutely frightened out of my wits. And it was such I'm just jubilant that it's over. That it's just, I had a wonderful... I did have a wonderful, loving companion who died. He died 2 days after the court granted my request for a hearing. For 4 years, we lived together, and he fought for me to have that hearing. And then as soon as we got, he had cancer at the end. And as soon as he found out that we had the hearing, he died. 2 days, he didn't even live 48 hours after that. And so then I had to have the hearing without him. And that was like very traumatic, but he always had this attitude that was really cool, which was, he hated self-pity, and he wasn't going to tolerate it. And he was like, you chose your values, and you have to, and he had this attitude. He was like, you chose your values, and when you believe in something, you have to be willing to pay the pay the price for your values, and you have to take your consequences. And he said, you should be, if you really believe in what you did, then you should be proud of yourself, and don't let these people take this away from you. So that was his attitude. So.
Just one last question.
Sure.
I'm just not familiar with the word asset, and Robin asked that question too. Okay. Can you just help me clarify what that really is? Is that like a secretary?
No. An asset is like an operative. It's like a field operative, except. An asset is a human asset is the eyes and ears that goes into the situation, into the room, and has direct contact with events. So assets are very, that's why assets are trained to be very, we are trained to be very observant of the full situation and to be very descriptive of what we're doing. And we're trained not to change what we've seen for any reason. And that was a real threat to the Bush administration, because it's just like you don't ever change your story. Because the detail that you think is small, that you think you might compromise, could turn out to be very important, because you are compartmentalized. And you're like seeing a picture of this. And they need to know what this is. They need to see what you see right here. Even if you don't know what's over there or what's over there, they have to know that this here that you're reporting is as accurate and precise as possible. Yeah. Except that they, yeah, basically, with the exception in this situation that the Libyans and the Iraqis both knew who I was from the first day that we went in. And they and the reason that the Libyans knew immediately, once I told the Libyans, it was over. I mean, I couldn't ever, you can't ever take it back. And that was that my CIA handler, Dr. Richard Fuse, was involved in the Lockerbie case, and he wanted to be a witness testifying in the Lockerbie case. And so we were starting, before I ever went to the Iraqis, we started talks for the Lockerbie trial with Libya, and we wanted the Libyans to know that if they would accept the trial, that his testimony would help exonerate their people. So then I had to tell them who I was. And so they knew, but I remember the first conversation I had with Mr. Amara at the Libyan embassy. He's like, we want to know why you are here. This is a very important question. It requires a very important answer. And so he was like, we want to know, what the heck are you doing? Because you people just didn't, in 1995, when I established contact with the Libya house, people just didn't wander into the Libya house. Believe me. You know, and if I had not been an asset, the FBI would have arrested me the minute I came out of there. You know. So they were told not to touch me. So
after you were locked up for a year, and then it was 5 years total that you weren't allowed to say anything?
Well, 5 years I was under indictment.
Okay.
So when you're under indictment, anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. However, what they had done was very clever, because when I was released from prison, the corporate media told everybody I was crazy. I had been declared, quote, incompetent to stand trial. And so I must be, you know, there must be something really wrong with me, so most people wouldn't listen to what I had to say anyway.
So what happened for the next 4 years?
And then say anything when you were starting to come out with this? And have you ever heard from anybody at your Mr. whatever his name is at the CIA again?
Well, very good questions. I was actually under indictment for 18 months before I got sent to prison, and then I was held for a year. So when I'm released from prison, that's actually the halfway mark of my case. Then I found another attorney, and it took him about another 18 months. It took try to understand what I'm saying to you. 2.5 years I'm under indictment, and I'm released from prison. For another 18 months, the court refuses to grant me a hearing after I've been released from prison. Because I get another attorney, he says, I can take her case. I can work with this woman. As far as I'm concerned, she is competent to help me assist in this defense. She is capable of assisting in her own defense if I'm taking it. He went into court. He stood in front of the judge. He assured the judge that he could work with me. This was not going to be a problem. Because the reason anyone's declared incompetent is if they're not capable of helping their attorney in the case.
What kind of court was it?
U.S. Federal Court, Southern District of New York. The first judge was Judge Michael Mukasey. He then retired, and a new judge took over, Loretta Preska. Her husband worked for Daddy Bush.
There's a surprise.
So
after that,
sorry. What happened until now?
Oh, and then we did have the hearing in June of 2008. Right before the presidential election in November. And we had begun doing radio to people like Michael Herzog at Oracle Broadcasting, Republic Broadcasting. The internet radio was giving me a lot of attention. And they were like, and they were helping to defend me. And when we had my witness testified in court about the 9/11 warnings, then it exploded out more. But again, the most people, yeah, only, but on the internet, people who like pay attention to the internet do know this story. And then they began to talk about it a lot more. But then my case continued another year. And my CIA handler, I'm told, has said that he's very sorry for he thinks it's really a shame what they did to me. He feels sorry for me. He does not feel sorry for what he did, but he says that I'm very sorry that they screwed Susan. But He didn't give me any money for my legal defense.
Did you hear anything from anybody about the book?
Oh, they, when I do radio interviews, there are funny things that happen, like my phone will cut out, and it'll just go dead. Like, I make sure that I have my batteries charged and all this stuff, and the phone will just drop out, and just the battery will just disappear. Or if they can't kill the phone call, sometimes there will be like a loud beeping noise, beep, 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 and all the way like through an hour interview without stop. It'll just continue all the way through.
Directly came up and threatened your publisher? Or...
Oh, well, I have had to self-publish it.
Okay.
Because the corporate press was like, they're like, no one wants to hear about 9/11. No one wants to hear this. And then we were afraid. We did have some smaller publishers who were willing to take it, but we were very much afraid at that point that a smaller publisher would be threatened and then they would close the book and they'd stop it. And so I decided that the safest way to go forward would be to self-publish it, and with my, hopefully, you know, by the time you realize I've got 700 footnotes, I've got the documents in here, I've got, you know, the affidavits in there, and now I'm safe because no one has sued me, no one's threatened to sue me, and so hopefully in the future, if I write a second book, then hopefully they'll pick up this one and both of them will be distributed. So, thank you. Anyway, this is like...